Come on. We have a couple of announcements. We'll start with Dennis.
Good morning. I'm Dennis Northway, your parish musician, and it gives me great pleasure to introduce our four new choral scholars for the year. Ellie O'Brien is our soprano. She is a sophomore. Emma Christensen is our alto. She's a junior. These are all at PLU. Kenneth Prince is our tenor, and he's a junior. And Trevor Hansen is our bass. He's a senior. Can you join me in welcoming them?
Thank you. Jeff.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Jeff Dalvin. And I'm here to invite you to participate in a parish workshop next weekend, Saturday the 18th, starting at 12:30. And we expect it'll run about 4 hours, and we'll have a social hour afterwards. What we're up to is reimagining our time together. So it's an important event for our parish. There's a journal that I think most of you, I hope, are aware of and have glanced at, maybe studied. But it invites us to ask some questions to take stock of ourselves, in relation to the pandemic the last 8 months, to take stock of our family. How did this impact our kids, our folks? How did it impact our lives as a church and also as a country, given all the dynamic events of the last election? And out of this, we hope to gain some insight that can guide us together as a faith community. Our time together will be facilitated by a woman named Melissa Skelton. She is a retired Archbishop in the Anglican Church, and now she is an assistant bishop in our own parish. We have found her to be absolutely delightful, intelligent, and so useful, donating her time to guide us forward. So I hope you can make it. Again, it's next Saturday, the 18th. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
I just wanted to let everybody know that our atrium is starting up again, which is our Sunday school. Because we are still in pandemic and because our children are not able to get vaccines yet, what our catechists have decided to do is offer atrium by household. So you will, if you want to have your children participate in our atrium lessons, you need to contact Stephen Hines and let him know which Sundays you would like to come at 9 o'clock and have your children do the atrium lessons. There are still offerings for children during our 10 o'clock service. They're downstairs right now because it's rainy. They're in the parish hall. They'll be outside as long as the weather lets them. So there is still offerings for children down in the parish hall. But if you want them to actually do the atrium lessons, please contact Stephen Hines to get that scheduled with him.
Thank you. Today we are blessed with a guest speaker who is someone who does very important work in the community. I will introduce you to her later, but just know that part of what I love about St. John's is how active and how involved you are in the community. So today we are going to be talking about food backpacks for children, so for kids. And so I will tell you more, or Michelle will tell you a lot about it, but I will introduce her later. Let us now prepare for worship. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Lord be with you.
Let us pray. O God, because without you we are not able to please you, mercifully grant that your Holy Spirit may in all things direct and rule our hearts. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated.
A reading from the book of Isaiah. The Lord God has given me the tongue of a teacher, that I may know how to sustain the weary with a word. Morning by morning he wakens my ear to listen as those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. I did not turn backward. I gave my back to those who struck me, in my cheeks to those who pulled out the beard. I did not hide my face from insult and spitting. The Lord God helps me. Therefore, I have not been disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand up together. Who are my adversaries? Let them confront me. It is the Lord God who helps me. Who will declare me guilty? The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
A reading from the letter of James. Not many of you should become teachers, my brothers and sisters, for you know that we who teach will be judged with greater strictness. For all of us make many mistakes. Anyone who makes no mistakes is perfect in speaking is perfect, able to keep the whole body in check with a bridle. If we put bits into the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we guide their whole bodies. Or look at ships. Though they are so large that it takes strong winds to drive them, yet they are guided by a very small rudder wherever the will of the pilot directs. So also the tongue is a small member, yet it boasts of great exploits. How great a forest is set ablaze by a small fire. And the tongue is a fire. The tongue is placed among our members as a world of iniquity. It stains the whole body, sets on fire the cycle of nature, and is itself set on fire by hell. For every species of beast and bird, of reptile and sea creature, can be tamed and has been tamed by the human species. But no one can tame the tongue, a restless evil full of deadly poison. With it we bless the Lord and Father, and with it we curse those who are made in the likeness of God. From the same mouth comes blessing and cursing. My brothers and sisters, this ought not to be so. Does a spring pour forth the same opening both fresh and brackish water? Can a fig tree, my brothers and sisters, yield olives, or a grapevine figs? No more can salt water yield fresh. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark.
Glory to you, Christ.
Jesus went on with the disciples to the villages of Caesarea Philippi, and on the way he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" And they answered him, "John the Baptist, and others Elijah, and still others one of the prophets." He asked them, "But who do you say that I am?" Peter answered him, "You are the Messiah." And he sternly ordered them not to tell anyone about him. Then he began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. Turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples, and he said to them, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it. And those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in glory, in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. The Gospel of the Lord.
Please be seated. In this morning's gospel lesson, Jesus is at Caesarea Philippi, and he is testing the faith of the disciples. He's trying to see how they see him and what his role is. So rather than starting out with the hard question, he asks an easy one. What are people saying about me? After they come up with a few answers, he gets to the heart of the matter. Who do you say that I am? So they tell him. They think he is the Messiah. Now, he isn't the Messiah that they were expecting, who would have been a warrior of sorts, but he is someone who is clearly called to give his life for his people. He is called to be a Messiah that is known not only for his sacrifice, but for his service. All of us that are his followers are called also to be people not only of service, but also of sacrifice. And so we are invited to join him in the building of the kingdom. Now, this will be elucidated further as we go through Mark's gospel even more, but in this particular day, what we're focusing on is what it means to be builders of the kingdom. What does it mean to be people of service? What does it mean to carry out and follow Jesus? Not the warrior king, but the man and the servant and the healer. Now, St. John's, in its mission goals, is called to work for the dignity and stability of our vulnerable neighbors. That's a beautiful statement, and I think it says it quite clearly in terms of how we are to carry this out, this mandate out within this place. It is with great pleasure that I introduce to you Michelle Johnson, who is the program manager for Food Backpacks for Kids. And you will hear that it is a program that has been adaptive and changed to the needs of the community around us, especially during pandemic time. And as it grows, it becomes more creative in its response. So it is with pleasure that I introduce to you Michelle Johnson.
Good morning. I could talk all day about my program. I think Dennis is supposed to give me the 10-minute and gives me some time. I am the program manager at Food Backpacks for Kids. Let's do a little interactive. Who has heard of Food Backpacks for Kids? Yes. All right. Who knows that we're a full food bank? A couple of hands. Who knows that we do backpacks in the schools? Okay. Who knows that we have a home delivery program for groceries? A couple people. Who knows that we have carrying closets in the middle schools and high schools? A couple people, good. We're gonna talk a little bit more about that. So our Food Backpack for Kids program started over 12 years ago, and I've been on board for 3 years now. And when I started, I knew working with the current executive director that we had at the time and founder that this program was going to explode. I just saw the potential there. I knew the need was in the community. She knew it was in the community. And we did. we exploded. We were hovering on exploding, and then when the pandemic hit, we really did. So we had a program that was taking small drawstring backpacks, and we were providing them to the schools, all the schools in the on the Key Peninsula and in Gig Harbor, so the Peninsula School District. And we were serving probably about 400 backpacks a week. And we provided enough food for a family to probably make one meal during the weekend and some snacks and some maybe some breakfast stuff for the children. But we knew we could do more. And then because we have close contacts in the schools, when the pandemic hit, I got a phone call from one of my close friends in the district and said, we're closing. I'm like, okay, well, if you're closing, we're not closing though. We cannot leave our community without the ability to feed their families and feed the children in the area. So within an hour, we flipped our entire model. Instead of bringing the food to families at the schools, we asked families to come to us. And at first we were nervous. We're like, it's kind of a private program. Our family's gonna come. And they did. And they came and they trusted us. And we've expanded our food backpack for kids' family. They have trusted us to help provide the nutritional food that they need every week for families. So for the last year or so, we've been providing drive-up food services. So families drive up to us. We had a site here on Gig Harbor and our site on Key Center. And they would come to us and we would provide them with boxes or bags of food depending on the size of their family. And we followed a menu. So it wasn't just, here you go, here's a bunch of miscellaneous food. Every box and bag had a purpose. So we would make sure that the families had some type of canned protein, rice, pastas, pancake mixes, things that they could make 3 to 4 meals a week for their families. And we did that through the entire pandemic. Now we know that we need to change again. Well, let me take a step back. And during that time, guess what we did? We bought freezers, we bought refrigerators, we hooked up with local farmers to provide produce. The ability to get food from the Emergency Food Network was greater. So we had milk and cheese and eggs, and we still have that. So instead of a small backpack now, we were providing all of this food for our families. And non-perishable foods sometimes aren't the most healthy foods, so now we can provide all the nutrition and meet all those needs. Now the school's back. What are we gonna do? Are we going back into the schools with backpacks? Yes, we will be doing that. Now we're also inviting our families to come in to us to shop for their groceries. And we will be ramping up our program with our caring closets. So now we also have the home delivery program, and part of your church community, people here, Susan is here. I'm gonna call her out way in the back there. And is Dr. Snyder here today? I don't know if he is, but Dr. Snyder, he helps us. And Christy Laybourne also in the back there, Madame, has been donating food for us since the pandemic hit with intention. She asks us, what do your families need? It's not, here's some food. It's what do your families need? And she listens. I say, we really need pinto beans for our Hispanic families. We really could use tortillas. We could use this coming up in the next month. She hears that, knows the needs of our community, and provides that for us. Susan is part of the Harbor Hope Transportation Volunteers. We've partnered with them to provide home delivery for our families. So if a family has one person's working, one car, that person can take that car to work, we can provide a home delivery. We have families with multiple special needs children who just can't get out. It's just not something that they're able to do. We provide the groceries with delivery for them. This week was our first week of the families coming to us, and it's a hit. It is, it's again, we're meeting the needs of the family. Instead of saying, we've created this menu and we think you need this, and here's some garbanzo beans too, because we have to get those out. Families can come and say, I don't need garbanzo beans this week. I use that as an example because we had a lot of garbanzo beans, and it's really every week they'd go, again, Michelle? And I'm like, I'm sorry. But they can look and they can see what's offered for the week, and they say, you know, this week I don't need canned corn. I don't have any recipes I really want to use this week with canned corn, but I really could use 6 boxes of mac and cheese because it's the first week of school and it's going to be a rough week. And I really, mac and cheese is easy, my kids will eat it. So we are allowing families to now choose what they need instead of us telling them what they need. And the feedback has been fantastic. Once school gets settled a little bit, any of you are parents, you know the first couple weeks is crazy. Well, they're feeling it in the schools too. So we're not right back in the schools with the backpacks, but we will be back there very soon. And our idea is to provide the food at the school level for families or kids to advocate for themselves if they need to get the food, and then hopefully connect them with us where they can come to us and get more groceries. So we will have backpacks back at the school for people to choose. They can choose to come to our site and shop. They could do both if they want. And we will also have the care cabinets at the middle school and high school levels, again, to reduce that barrier that food is accessible to anybody. It's not a right to have, it's a human right to have food. It's not a privilege to have food, it's a right. And we need those kids to be able to have a safe place where they can go and say, I really need a snack to get through math class. I need something. Or at the high school level, we have students who are couch surfing. They're not in their home. And so every night they're finding somewhere else to go. And for them to be able to go to a care closet and pick out some pasta and spaghetti sauce where they can put it in their own backpack, go to a friend's house, and they could actually make the meal. We've heard stories of that. They are empowering themselves and they feel like they're contributing because they took the food, made a meal at the house that they're staying at. We also have children who are, they're in the woods, they're sleeping in the woods. So if we have kid-friendly, accessible food, pop-top soups like that, they can put it in their backpack and they can have something for that evening. So providing the food directly in the schools is huge for us. And then on top of that, we have our come shop at our pantry. So all those levels with our home delivery service, we're excited. Now let's talk a little bit about what we're seeing for food insecurity. Sometimes when you think about that, think about what comes to your mind. You think of, it's the lower income, that family down there, they're the ones that are poor, this. There's no one picture of food insecurity in Gig Harbor or the Key Peninsula. It's across the board. We have families coming to us who have 2 people working full-time, good jobs, who still cannot make the ends meet. And when they come to us and they ask us for food and we provide it and we save them $50, $60 a week, that money, now they can make a choice to pay that medical bill. They can fix the tire on their car so they can continue to go to work to provide. It has taken a little bit of stress off of them. Think about the choices we have to make every day for our families and sometimes how stressful it can be. And to not be able to provide enough food for your family is one more stress. And when we come and they come and we, no judgment, how are you doing? What's going on this week? Yeah, I've had a horrible week too. Make those connections with our family, provide them with a box full of food that they can go home and go, I can make some meals this week, just to see that. And we call it the Food Backpacks for Kids family because we have made those connections with our delivery drivers. I know Susan, we talk, we both lived in Hawaii. We make that connection. I see her every week. I know a little bit about her family. She knows about mine. She knows I'm a hot mess right now because my daughter, my only child, has gone to college and I'm an empty nester now. What am I gonna do with that? Same with our families. We know their stories and we talk to them and we listen and we meet the needs that they have. Oh, okay, I gotta wrap it up. So we also provide summer lunch program. We have volunteer opportunities. We had to ask our older population of volunteers to step back for a while. We're welcoming them back. We want youth volunteers. We want that. We're starting to grow a garden next year. We started this year. It looks really sad because we started too late, but we're going to have a garden. We have lots of opportunities for you to get involved. If it's just buying some macaroni and cheese and putting it in our donation shed. Whatever, you guys are a part of our Food Backpacks for Kids family. We are a family. You guys have always been very supportive of us. Come visit us. I'll give you a tour. You guys came out earlier this week. We'll hook you, and then you won't want to leave.
Great, thank you. Stay right there.
Okay.
Part of what I love about this program is the fact that they've been around for 12 years, and that they have a lot of people involved, and that they're very versatile in terms of what their needs are. As you heard, how they adapted to the pandemic. There are issues also. I asked about whether they had ethnic food, because a lot of times what happens with food banks is people are given food that they are not necessarily eating because it's not what they would eat, or they're eating it, but they would prefer to be eating this. And so she told us a wonderful story about a particular kind of flour that's used to make tortillas, and how they searched far and wide. Actually, it's not flour, it's corn. That's great things. The other thing is, one of the hidden poor in a lot of communities are the elderly. We don't know that, and we don't talk about it very much. But not only are they themselves poor, but they have grandchildren as well. And for them to be able to get food and to serve their grandchildren is really important, because we all want to share and give our kids what they want. So this is a wonderful opportunity to do that. So, of course, they need money. That's the way life works. Nonprofit organizations, even ones that are run well, rely on income from other sources. And churches are one of those sources. And St. John's has set aside 5% actually of its budget to go to various projects, four different projects. And one of them is food backpacks for kids. I'll get it right. I don't have another service, but I'll get it right eventually. And so the idea is that what we want to do is augment that. It's really important that we dig deep out of our own pockets, because, you know, the truth is that the pandemic has been a very uneven thing. A lot of us have done fairly well during the pandemic, while others have not. So I invite you to dig into your pocket, and checks can be made out to, you make it out to St. John's, and in the memo line put food backpacks for children. You can do that if you have a check with you. If not, you can go home and do it online, go onto the church's website and make a note as you do it that it's for this particular project. So, questions? Anybody have any questions on Michelle?
Where are you located?
So our actual facility is in Key Center. So we're on the Key Peninsula. But our reach, like I said, is the greater Key Peninsula and all of Gig Harbor. And because we are actually a full food bank as well, is our focus is families and children, but anyone can come to us. It does not matter if your age. We don't ask income, we don't ask for ID, nothing. If you need food, you can come to us. But we are located in the Key Peninsula.
Any other questions? Yes.
Not as much as we'd like to. We would like to do a lot more. Even during the pandemic times, we were like, we really need to partner with BISH. We do talk to them. We know what their programs are. We refer people to them. They refer people to us in that way. But there's no official coordination with them.
Okay. Thank you very much for the work you do. And let's give her a big hand. Let us stand and reaffirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We We believe in one God,
Father, the Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten by the Father, God from God,
light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things are made. For us, for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. St. John's, what do you want?
We want to be like Jesus.
St. John's, what does that mean?
We want to love to serve God and our neighbors as ourselves.
St. John's, what will that require?
I ask your prayers for God's people everywhere, for our presiding Bishop Michael, for our Bishop Greg, for our rector Eric during his sabbatical rest, our sabbatical priest Marion, our deacon postulant Kay, our missionary Cricket Meyer, and for all who minister at St. John's. Pray for the church. I ask your prayers for this nation and all in authority, for healing between racial communities, for the president, Congress, and courts, for the governor and state legislature, and for the mayor and city council. Pray for justice in every form. I ask your prayers for the welfare of the world, for nations at war, for the victims of corruption, violence, and natural disasters, for communities where the pandemic is still spreading, for the well-being of the environment, and especially for those in Afghanistan and those recovering from the hurricanes, fires, and floods. Pray for those in any need or trouble. I ask your prayers for this community, remembering especially those served through our ministries and mission partners, St. John's English Language Community, the Prison Ministry, Alcoholics Anonymous, the Harbor Hope Center, Fish Food Bank, and especially food backpacks for kids. Pray for our neighbors. I ask your prayers for members of St. John's living with chronic illness, Joan Hansen, Jerry Violet, Kathleen Richter, John Hayes, J.T. Bottom, Frank Knight, Carol Hughes, Bev Moore, and for parishioners who have asked for prayers at this season in their lives, Ken and Ginger Behrens, Sarah Ann Cooper, Linda Bruhn, Roger Scott, Joe Malik, Susan Ayler, Jenny Bittner, Jeff Waters, Doug Hughes, Debbie Smith, Xavier Roscoe, Mike Harris, and for our family members and friends, Leanna Mayer, Richard Breland, Stephen Breland, Andrea Stearns, Larry and Cindy, David Blake, Dan Ferguson, John Lipko, Kate Berry, Dale, and Kelly, and for whom else shall we pray? Pray for those who are struggling for summer. I ask your prayers for those who seek God and for those whose hope for meaning in this life is diminished. Pray for inspiration. I ask your prayers for the departed, especially those lost on 9/11 and all who have died since in the war on terror. Pray for those who have died.
Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen us to do your will, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Let us humbly confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us greet one another from a distance. If you'd like to receive a gluten-free wafer, feel free to come forward as well.
and best way to do that is to turn your hands over, and then I know that you're actually wanting gluten-free. You can turn it back over so I can put it in there, but it just is a good signal to me in terms of what to give you. The other thing is, I forgot birthdays and anniversaries. I have a terrible habit of doing that. Do we have any? Yes, next time I do, if you can start playing Happy Birthday, that it's not just here again, all my career crap. Okay. Open your heart, offer it to God, so that we may serve God and help others. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
God of all power, ruler of the universe, you are worthy of glory and praise.
Lord,
at your command, all things came to be. The vast expanse of interstellar space
galaxies, suns, the planets in their courses, and this fragile earth, our island home. From the primal elements, you brought forth the human race and blessed us with memory, reason, and skill. You made us the rulers of creation, but we turned against you and betrayed your trust, and we turned against one another. Again and again, you called us to return. Through prophets and sages, you revealed your righteous law. And in the fullness of time, you sent your only son, born of a woman, to fulfill your law, to open for us the way of freedom and peace. Therefore, we praise you, joining with the heavenly chorus, with prophets, apostles, and martyrs, with all those in every generation who have looked to you in hope to proclaim with them your glory in their unending hymn. So, Father, we who have been redeemed by him and made a new people by water and the Spirit, now bring before you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be the body and blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread, said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his friends and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, gave thanks, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering now his work of redemption, and offering to you the sacrifice of thanksgiving, we celebrate his death and resurrection. Lord God of our fathers and mothers, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, open our eyes to see your hand at work in the world about us. Deliver us from the presumption of coming to this table for solace only, and not for strength, for pardon only, and not for renewal. Let the grace of this Holy Communion make us one body, one spirit in Christ, that we may worthily serve the world in his name. Risen Lord, known to us the breaking of bread. Accept these prayers and praises, Father, through Jesus Christ, our great High Priest, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit your church gives honor, glory, and worship, from generation to generation.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
The gifts of God for the people of God. Holy things for holy people. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. You have fed us with spiritual food and the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God. Jesus Christ, his Son, our Lord. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen.
To love and serve the Lord.